All right, this is another update on redoing the guest bathroom, and it's finishing up the mirrors around there and a couple little things. And first off, my wife had made this curtain that's been hanging in there for several years, and we're looking for a curtain rod, so off to the Amazon warehouse, and I wanted it to be matching to the Gatco stuff I have, so I found a Gatco toilet paper holder. Just one of the old spring type that I thought would work, and it was like a $30 item that I got for under $7, $6.80 something or something like that as used. So I ordered that and came through. It was brand new, all the hardware and everything was there. And then that light that I had bought at Rehouse for the other end of the bath, I had this down rod left from it that I took out, and that was just the right length for the cross rod, so I took and I just shoved a couple bolts in there that fit tightly to make it fit nice and tight in these little chrome holders. And there I have my curtain rod for the bathroom that's matching to everything else in there. So it's just, seeing how it's a Gatco, it mounts exactly as all the other parts that I had shown you mounting back in that other video. So you just have to drill a couple holes inserts, and these are the little plastic inserts because I didn't hit studs on these, and you just pop them in, and there's this red button that you tap them in to open them up inside the wall so they lock in place nice and tight. And then it's just a matter of installing a bracket for them. Now I decided to mount these brackets upside down so the set screw would be on the top and you wouldn't be able to see it. So same thing, just came with all the mounting hardware and screws and everything, so I just got them mounted in place, and with the bracket in place I was able to just slip that rod in, slide this other side on, and you can see how I'm clipping it in from the bottom upside down. So once this set screw gets locked down on the bracket, this thing will never come down. You can hang whatever you want on it, and it's up there really good. So there it is, my curtain rod, and there's the embroidered curtain that my wife made several years ago, like I said, and still goes good in there, so I'm real happy the way that came out. And now it's back down into the shop to finish up on a little pull-out stool for underneath the vanity, and I have to put some inserts in. Well, I got inserts with the these little feet, but I didn't like the inserts because I was afraid they might split to cherry, so I decided to just use nuts. So I found a bigger drill that was like a press fit for the nut, and I drilled it in there deep enough just for two nuts. I figured I would go double on them just to make sure nothing would wiggle. And so I got a small hole going in there, and I bought this box of feet on Amazon for less than 4 feet would have cost at Home Depot. So I can put a link to that. They're little metric feet, and they work pretty good. And then I just used a bar clamp to press the nuts, and you can see how tight they go into there. And pretty much that should hold the feet good. And they're sitting in there flush, so I can just kind of screw them up to the number that I need. And then it's time to go over and start breaking down some more of my rough cut lumber for the frame for around the mirror. So I'm using this evolution saw and really enjoy that, and then over to the bandsaw to start splitting it down so it's under 8 inches wide, so it'll go on my joiner. So I just trim the trim it in the center there where it's bowed, and trim off the sides and have some firewood left over. And then right after that I had to make a little piece for the front of the stool that you could get your foot under to just kind of pull it out with and push it in with. So I just used a bandsaw to rough that out. I wanted it kind of the exact same radius that's on the front of the top, so I copied that. And then over to this jet belt sander, and you can see the belt on it's getting pretty beat up. I've been using the same belt since I got it. This was one of those eBay belts that I bought, and I think it's pretty amazing. Gonna have to switch the belt soon, but it's really a great piece of machinery that I've had no problems with, and wish I had bought it years ago, because it makes things like this so easy to clean up. don't have to worry about cutting right down to the line. So I got that all trimmed out and, you know, sanded down in time to just glue it onto the front there of the stool. And again, I got these little glue bots and I really enjoy them. They work really great for spreading glue. And that's how I used to spread it before I got the silicone brushes or when I can't find them. So spread some glue out there and time to just kind of get this clamped on the front there. And you can see I've got a piece of that laminate flooring sitting there, so I get the elevation perfect on it. So again, you always can never have enough clamps when you're working on jobs like this. So I got that all glued in, glue dried, and I, you know, sanded down the edge, and then I just started sanding it, putting on three coats of that min wax. In the meantime, if you saw the last video, I've had trouble with the this Craig jig. It was buckling there. You can see right between those screws from about, not Craig, I mean Incra, buckling in front of this, between the screws here. So I found out exactly where it was buckling, and I called them, and they're actually going to send out a new center panel, they said. They haven't seen that happen before, so I decided until I get that one, I don't know how long it'll take, I'm just going to take this existing one and machine away any of the high spots, because, you know, I need to get this job done, so, you know, this is the easiest way to get me back up and running. So I put some three millimeter plywood down on the table there just to, you know, space it off the top so I could get a nice flat cut. And machining enough to get rid of the buckles and, you know, basically a little bit of that red stuff on there too. This stuff actually routed really easy. It came right off there. It's pretty soft, and the substrate that they use on this, actually, I don't even know what it is. It's kind of like an MDF, you can see there, but it's got like a real soft balsa wood chips in it. They're super soft and squishy and stuff. So I decided I'm just going to go back and try to seal up anything that's left, just to try to avoid problems later, just see if it makes a difference. But like I said, there should be a new one on the way, so, you know, this is just to get me by for now. But yeah, it's kind of like a strange MDF with something else in it. So there it is. I'm letting that dry, and, you know, it's time to go back over here and get this thing, do the final sanding on it. So I just, you know, go back through and sand everything with 320, and then I just start heading down to some finer grits, and then I take some 4-0 steel wool with some of that Johnson's paste wax and give it a buffing out. And that polycrylic really takes about 90 days to dry, so I'm going to have to do this again in the future. And it's time to just screw the feet in, and you can see they screw right up in there. And finish is dry on this, so I'm going to go over and just put this all back together now. And it looks like it got everything flat, so I'll be able to use it for now. It's funny because the board on the side there has absolutely no swelling. It's perfectly parallel all the way along and stuff, and just that one center board. So then it's time to start cutting the flooring for the stool. And these are just some little scraps of laminate that I had left over from the flooring in the bathroom there. And I had no full pieces, so I wound up cutting it out of two smaller sections that I had left, and just clicking them together. It's amazing. I just came out with the perfect amount for that job. And, you know, luckily I had bought 10% over, too. So I got them cut, clicked together, and then I just have some of this low VOC liquid nail stuff. It dries, but it doesn't really get hard. It remains kind of flexible, so I figured it would expand and contract with that flooring. So I'm just going to use that to mount this little piece of this click and lock flooring on my stool. A little bit of glue on the back, and then I'm just gonna use some spring clamps to hold it in place till that glue sets up there. couple clamps across the front to squeeze out the extra glue. And then I had some gaps on the end where this stuff's going to expand and contract. So I found a piece of aluminum down in my shop, a little piece of angle. Brought that up and I cut two pieces. And this evolution saw has been really great for, you know, it's good for everything. So it's real handy in the shop instead of just a woodworking saw. So I got some nice clean cuts on there, and I rounded the edges on the grinder a little, drilled a couple holes, and buffed it up with the buffer, and I'm just going to use that to cover the two edges there where I left room for expansion and contraction of the flooring itself. So I had some of these old carpet strip nails I decided to use. I'm just going to tack this in place for now, and you really won't see it later when the thing is pushed in, so I figured it'd be good enough, and that way you don't see the black edge of the flooring there. So that pretty much finishes that up, and all ready to take up and install, which is an easy job because the slides are already mounted on that pedestal if you look back at the one of the earlier videos there. So I just had to get the slides engaged and slide it in. And there you can see, pulls out. And I made it for my granddaughter, but I figure if it'll hold 225 pounds of me, it should easily hold my granddaughter. So, and that looks like it'll be successful. And then I got this Incra jig back together. And I wound up taking the fence off my Craig miter jig because I like that much better, that little stop on it and stuff. And you can see there's the Incra fence, and against the Craig, even with the 3/4 inch plywood on the front, I've got an extra 1/2 inch of capacity behind the blade for cutting. So I'm gonna probably in the future get a longer one of them just to mount on here permanently. And then it's time to go back, and I jointed and planed this lumber. Now it's time to go back and just cut it, cut everything to width for the mirror frame. So I try to cut out the worst parts that I can, and try to just kind of save the best piece of the wood with character to match everything else. And there you can see I'm back to using that stop that I built into the fence for repeat cuts. And that actually works good too. So this sled is actually easier to use with this Craig piece on there, because see how you can get your fingers, you can actually get your fingers under there and lock it good. It's with the and it's lighter to push, so this makes it easier on me. So I'm happy now. And one of the reasons why I went with a frame like this that's this wide around the mirror is because I'm just trying to hide some of the size of it. So these are just some dados that I'm cutting in the backside where the frame is going to lap over the mirror, and I'm going to hide several inches on each side and the top and the bottom. So I'm just using the dado head there to cut 1.5 inches out of the back of there, and that'll give me a 3-inch smaller looking mirror. And I just slid the fence over so I could do two cuts and get 1.5 inches like that. And I must say I really like those little push blocks that I got from Rockler a while ago with the soft rubber on the bottom of them. They do work good, and they had a lot of safety. And then it's back over. I just decided to throw a chamfer bit in my little DeWalt compact router there to break some of the edges on here to match the chamfer on the actual tongue and groove that I put on the side, that V-groove stuff. I'm just put a couple chamfers on here, and I didn't feel like setting up the table. It was just as easy to just grab this and do it quick. But then for the V grooves in there, I'm gonna switch over the bit to a 45 degree V groove bit. And I tell you what, the 66 piece MLCS router bit set has really been handy, and I've had really good luck with all the bits that I've used. So I'm real happy with that purchase. it's nice having a bit for, you know, just about any job or any angle that you want, and it didn't really cost a lot. So I got that all loaded in the router table and all set to go, and what I'm going to do is put a couple of V-grooves to match the tongue and groove V-grooves in the side there. So first thing I'm going to do is zero out the tip of the bit there so I, you know, can set the depth later. So I'm just going to zero that out on the DRO. And then the same thing, I'm just going to bring the fence forward so I can go back and zero that DRO out on the fence so I can set my groove spacing. So nice being able to just push a button and not have to worry about fiddling with clamps and screws and knobs and stuff to hold it in place. This really has worked out good for me. So there it is. I got the zero set on that and the depth of the bit. So then from there I can, you know, go back to my 1-inch offset from the edge that I'm going to be using. And that way I know I've got exactly 1 inch without fiddling around. There it is. And then the depth of cut, I'll set that once I get a piece of that tongue and groove to match it. I want it to be identical. And then it's just time to put some V-grooves in there. Now with these little point cutting V-groove bits, you do have to feed a little bit slower, just because the actual surf cutting speed of the bit is slower in the center there, so you don't want it to burn. So you just have to take your time and feed it slow, otherwise cherry, you can burn pretty bad. And you can see with all these little guards and hold down, this thing is really a safe table to use. You can't even get near the cutter, and everything comes out cut really perfect. Sure is nice to finally have a decent router table. So I got them in there, and then it's time to biscuit it together. And I've got a 1/4-inch offset between the bottom and top piece and the vertical slats. So what I did is to get the biscuits to come out 1/4-inch, I used a spacer of 1/4-inch plexiglass here on the ends of the top and the bottom there. You can see to locate the biscuits, and they're really a little bit too narrow for the pins in the biscuit joiner to keep it from sliding around. So in the end I wound up clamping them all like that, you can see, with a spacer in there, and was able to get my biscuit joints in the bottom and top. And then the verticals, I'm just going to go back and no spacer in them, so that'll give me 1/4-inch offset like that. And there you can see. So with biscuits all cut and everything clamped together here, I'm just going to go back and take that polycrylic, and I'm going to go around all the areas where I'm going to glue and go back about 1 inch on each side of it and just put a coat of polycrylic there, so I will not see any glue squeeze out. I'll be able to just clean it up easily later. And there you can see the outline of the polycrylic. So that way the glue won't stick in those areas. Once it squeezes out, I can just take a paper towel and wipe it off. So now it's time to glue it up. And same thing, just get some glue on all the surfaces. And these little glue bots and baby glue bots really do make a big difference. They make it so it's real controllable dealing with a job like this. And get everything glued up and go back and do a final check for a square, and it's ready to go. So now I need to space out this frame 1/4 inch for the thickness of the mirror glass, and I just want it to be spaced from the wall. I have a 45 on the back, and then I want that to look like the frame is floating. So I've got this 1/4-inch by 1/2-inch strip going back here on each side. And I just clamped a 4-foot straight edge on there, because when you rip a strip this small, it's hard to keep it straight. So I figured I'll just clamp it in place up against that straight edge, and you know, that way I know I've got a nice straight line on there. And that you can see that chamfer on the back there is perfectly revealed. And then I got out the old Harbor Freight pin gun and went back and just threw some pins in there to hold it so I could take the clamps off of it. Threw them on both sides. This thing I've had for, you know, many years now, and it was only about a $10 item, but it finally did give out on me. And then it's time to cut the trim for the top and bottom, and same thing back over to this sander here. I need to put some radiuses on the end, and seems to be the perfect place to do it. And then I'm just going to clamp them in place, and same thing with the polyurethane to hide, to prevent glue squeeze out. And it only takes about a half hour to dry, and then I'm, you know, right back to gluing it all together. So seems to be the easiest way for me to, you know, come out with a no glue squeeze out in the end on a, when you put the final finish on. There it is, everything's lined up. And just kind of time to clamp it in place first. And then I was going to go back and put a couple pin nails in it to hold it, but shot two pin nails and they stopped coming out. And looks like this gun is shot now. So I just decided to pull it apart, and you can see that the nails are just kind of really jammed in there and squeegeed up. And from the looks of it, what I could see, the end of that little driving pin is not... It's a little bit cockeyed. Looks like it's worn down somewhat. So I just kind of pried those nails out of there, put some WD-40 in there, and put it back together, and got a couple more shots out of it. And then it stopped again. Jammed again. And so from the looks of it, the that little driver is shot. So I got out my old Porter cable 18-gauge brad nailer, and this thing I've had forever, and it's never given me a problem, so I just figured I'd finish up with this for now. And I was wondering how long my little, you know, $10 or $12 Harbor Freight pin nailer was going to last, and I did get quite a bit of use out of it. So just for the heck of it, I decided to pull the trigger and get that little driver to stick out and flatten it on the grinder just a hair to see if that would make it work again, and definitely it did. After that, no problem, worked again, but the it just leaves too big a hole where that driver goes down in now, instead of just a little pinhole. So you can see it really needs a new driver, but I don't know where I could get it from, so I'll be in the market for a new one of these little pin nailers in the future. Then it's back to three coats of this polycrylic on both sides of everything and sanding between it. And now I'm starting to cut up some stock for the door, actual door fronts for the vanity. Back over this Evolution saw, and this thing's really nice. I really like the little clamp on it, because when you're cutting up this rough cut stock, you see where it's bowed out in front of the table there? If you don't clamp that down, it can actually kick in when it's cutting and bind the saw pretty good. So, you know, that clamp really is a helpful feature to have on the saw. And then back over to the bandsaw. Hopefully someday I'll be able to find a track saw that's affordable, so I can, you know, just break this down with a track saw. But in the meantime, this is how I do it. And I do wind up with a lot of, you know, little scrap pieces for smoking wood, and actually for kindling too. So as long as everything's down below the 8-inch wide width for my joiner, I'm fine. So this is just another piece trimming down. Sometimes you wish you had a 12-inch joiner, but they're just so big and take up so much space that I think 8's about the perfect size. And then it's time to sand that down and wax it, do the final sanding, and clear. I tried to clean the mirror, but I didn't do a good job. And then just make sure everything fit. Now, when I measured it, I left an 1/8 inch clearance for the mirror, and it turns out that the mirror was actually a parallelogram. So I had to go back down in the shop and just machine out a little bit more to make a fit, because it was out of square by 1/4 inch. So that was pretty amazing. can't believe that it came that way. So anyhow, I put some double-sided tape just to temporarily hold it together after, you know, opening that space up a little bit. And I'm just going to stick this on the mirror to temporarily hold it in place. And you can see it really is a nice quarter-inch plate glass mirror, but it just was too big for in there. And I didn't really want to buy a smaller mirror, so I decided that this frame would actually make it look smaller and hide a lot of the glass, like you can see. Time to mount it in place, and this thing's really heavy now. With the frame and the mirror all together, it's probably about 80-90 pounds. So I put a little bit of construction adhesive across the bottom here just to kind of hold it in place. I know it's not going to be going anywhere, but I just figured that would keep it nice and tight. And I put those spring clamps on just while I was moving it around so that, you know, to hold everything together just in case. And I can get it in position there and take all the clamps off now. And I'm just going to push it back, and that little strip of adhesive across the bottom will hold the bottom in place. And the wall is not exactly, it's got a little bow out in the top corner. So that's why I needed the adhesive. And I'm just going to clamp some blocks of wood in place to hold that bottom back until everything's dry and it, you know, stuck in place. There it is, mirror's in place, and now I'm just took that Craig jig drill, and just like to use that for when I'm going to drill in at 45 degrees and I want to countersink a screw in there and hide the head. So you can start that, the small diameter bit in, and then turn it sideways and go in on an angle. And then I just went back with a couple of 2-inch Craig screws on an angle into the stud up there to really hold it good. So that, that was the easiest way to mount it down. And there it is. Got the mirrors all in place. You can see I didn't do a good job cleaning it. Still got to go back and do that. But a couple clamps here and boards just holding it till everything sets up for a couple hours. So here we are. Glue's all dry. And I take a quick video of it in position and just show you how that did actually, take several inches off the mirror in each direction and made it look a little bit better. I would have liked it a little bit smaller, but, I'm happy at this point. And there's that footstool. You just kick it out with your foot and, push it back in. So that actually worked out. And here comes the boss to put her stamp of approval on everything. Even this little stool looks tall to her with her 2-inch long legs. And on Amazon, I found this little cup holder. It was just a plastic holder with some double-sided tape, and I decided to make a nice little cherry backing plate to mount it on, and that kind of finished that off. So you can see I've made a little more progress in the last week or so, and finally got the mirror up, and got the curtains up, and got the stool all finished up, and it's all approved by the boss here, so ready to move on to the next step. I'm real happy with that little cup holder too. That worked out nice. So now I've got to start building the light. I've got some LEDs coming to work on that and make the doors for the cabinet in the next video. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe.